Good morning. How's everybody today? I will make a couple of announcements. First of all, I want to welcome you to our service this morning. If you're our guest this morning, this is your first time with us, we want to let you know for sure that you are an answer to our prayers, that we are glad you are here with us, and we have been praying for you to come and to be a part with us today. And we want to encourage you to register with us, to register as our guest this morning. You can do that at the Connect table, Connect desk back there. You can also do that. There should be a QR code in front of you on a card right there, and you can click, take a picture of that, QR code, and it will take you to our website where you can register as our guest there, or you can just do it in person back at the Connect desk. There's a gift packet back there if you have never received one of those, or if you're our first-time guest, we'd love to give you one of our gift packets back there. You can get that at the Connect desk. As always, we've got our offering boxes up here. There's one up here and one in the foyer. That's the way you can give this morning, as well as you can give online on our website. You can also give through the bringing it into the office. So that's all the ways you can give with us. We'd love for you to follow us on Facebook and on YouTube. Our Sunday services are live on Facebook, and then we edit them and put them on YouTube every week, so you can go back and watch old ones or catch up with us. For the most part, we've had a couple of services where things just didn't record correctly, but for the most part, we're able to put all that online, so you can go back and see all that content online. March the 20th is our membership class. So if you are a guest with us and are interested in membership with the church, you can certainly come to that membership class. That's one of the two things that we ask that people do. One is to attend a Connect lunch, and then the other is to attend the membership class. That's part of the membership process here at Center Fork. And so you can see that on March the 20th, and we'll get you more information on that. This coming Saturday is Kayla Mulling's wedding shower. Can you believe that? Those of you who've been around here ages like me, little Kayla, who used to walk around in high heels and a tutu all the time, is now getting married. Just tell me she's not going to wear a tutu for her wedding. Okay. It was not uncommon. But anyway. All right, so Kayla is getting married, and the wedding shower is coming up this weekend on Saturday at 2. And I think that's all the announcements that I have. We'll get things started with the scripture this morning. Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 3 through 6 says, "But I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and bring them back to their folds, and they shall be fruitful and increase. I will set up shepherds over them who will feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, nor shall they be lacking, says the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise to David a branch of righteousness. A king shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell safely. Now this is his name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness." Someday we will get to see Jesus face to face. And until he comes, he has set shepherds over us to work in his place with him and with the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us. And I think we're going to talk a little bit about maybe some of those early shepherds this week, today. So, all right, this morning, we're going to do things just a little bit different. We're going to pray, but I am honored, truly honored, to serve with two wonderful men here at this church, our pastor, our Brother Scott, who is hiding behind me, sort of, and our youth pastor, Caleb, who's also behind me, also hiding behind me. And both of these guys sing really well. Brother Scott, actually, early on in his ministry and through his time in the mission field, he was worship leader. And so I asked him, "Hey, can you lead this song? And then I'll sing harmony." So he's going to lead Lord of Hosts with us, and Caleb's going to sing harmony, and I'm going to sing harmony, and we're going to have a little bit of fun with that, and y'all sing along. So we're going to start things off with prayer here first, and then I'll have Brother Scott lead us. Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you so much for the opportunity to come together and to worship you this morning, to lift your name in praise. We thank you that you have provided for us, that you have given us the things that we need to survive in this world around us, no matter how crazy it gets. Lord, help us remember that you are our King and that we serve you. And this is your world and your even your country, Lord. And even through all the craziness that's going on in the world around us, Lord, you are still sovereign. You are still King, and we want to lift your name in praise. Lord, we just ask that you bless our service time. If there's anything that would hinder our worship, please deal with that in us. Get it out of the way so that we can worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, we thank you for your love and your blessings. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right. Let's stand together.
Stand with me. Oh, come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and tells the wars to cease. Oh, mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. Walk by faith in God who burns. Lord of hosts, go with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go but with the Lord?
Through the fiercest battle, oh, where else would we go?
it good? Isn't it wonderful to know that we have the Lord of hosts,
amen,
who is with us in the fire, with us as a shelter in the fire, with us as a shelter in the storm? How many of you are going through a storm right now? Let me see. Our family is. You know, there's sometimes you got little storms, and sometimes you got big storms. Sometimes you got storms that you don't want anybody to know about. So it's like, I ain't raising my hand. I want everybody to think my life is perfect. Dr. Mike, you been through a storm this week? Mm-hmm. Hey, I bet every one of us have been through a storm this week in some way. And we have a Lord, a God, who, get this, I'm going to try not to preach, Brother Scott. That's his job today. My turn's coming, but anyway. This God literally spoke, and everything that is came into existence. Now, there are people who don't believe that. They believe that there was a cosmic accident and two things that came out of nowhere bumped into each other for no reason and created everything. But I'm sorry, that's just as hard to believe. So if you're going to believe something that fantastic, why not believe in the God of all creation who can create everything and be this loving, wonderful God who had that great power to create everything and then had so much love that he was willing to come to this earth for you and for me and give his life so that he could conquer sin, death, and hell by raising from the dead and offering that freely to anyone who will believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Savior and Lord. Wow! What an incredible God we have. And because of that, we can sing songs like this next one. I know not why God's wondrous grace to me he hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for his own. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Lori, take off. Let's sing.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me has.
Our hope in life and death, Christ alone, Christ alone.
What is our hope?
offer my life to you. Everything, get this, everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life. Let's sing it together. Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, use it for you.
When Kingdoms Collide, as Jesus sends out his apostles. So Matthew chapter 10, I'll be reading verses 5 through 15 in just a moment. Is this yours? Yeah. Could you get me a little bottle of water? Yeah. Before we open God's Word together, let's pray. Would you bow with me? Father, help us to hear, help us to learn, open our hearts and minds to your word and your Holy Spirit to do your work. We ask you, Father, as we open your book, that you would open us and you would help us to look honestly in the light of your glory and the light of your truth. You would bring us to repentance if it's needed. You would bring us to faith if we're doubting. You would bring us to joy if we're despairing. You would bring us to surrender if we're being stubborn. That, Father, you would do a work in us as we open your book together and we hear what you have to say to us. We ask you to do this for our good, but most importantly, for the glory of your Son, Jesus, and his gospel. In his name we pray. And everyone said, Jesus Christ is the King of Heaven. This is one of the themes of the Gospel of Matthew. He is the true King of God's glorious kingdom. So when Jesus came in his incarnation, the kingdom of heaven was colliding with the kingdom of men and even the kingdom of Satan. You can see this in his birth. When Jesus was born, angels came from heaven, made themselves known, and announced his arrival, right? But the kingdom of men, Herod, wanted to kill him. So now as we come to this part of chapter 10, as Jesus has chosen his 12 men, Jesus is now assembling his kingdom. And don't miss the obvious thing that everyone else in Jerusalem and Judea and Galilee would have noticed. They had 12 tribes, and how many apostles did he choose? This isn't by mistake. This is on purpose. This is Jesus assembling his kingdom. This is Jesus getting ready to send out his men. Thank you, Sean. So as we look at this passage of Scripture, I want you to understand that although this ministry that the apostles are going to go on was a temporary, short-term mission trip with temporary instructions, we can learn a whole lot about what it's going to be like for us when we try to take the gospel to the world. When we go outside of these walls and outside of our small group or outside the comfort of our home and we try to actually live the Christian life, we actually try to obey Jesus out there where it's hard to obey Jesus. When we go outside of these doors and we actually try to share Jesus with people who don't know him, we will experience a clash of kingdoms. And this passage prepares us for that. Now today we're going to look at this collision from a positive perspective. We're going to look at this collision from heaven's perspective. From heaven's perspective, on this side of it, we are announcing Jesus Christ is the King. Let's read this text. These 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, "Do not go into the way of the Gentiles. Do not enter a city of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach." Surely there's a better way. Surely he needs to talk to a marketing firm. I mean, Jesus, don't you know that preaching is, it was out of fashion 2,000 years ago, right? I mean, come on, Jesus, go and preach. Saying, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick and cleanse the lepers and raise the dead and cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Provide neither gold nor silver nor copper in your money belts. Don't take your money." How many of you think we need money to do God's kingdom work? Ooh, boy, we have made that mistake here in America. We got to have money to obey Jesus. Not these guys. Look at the next one. Don't take a bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor staffs. No swords. You're going to go forth into this battle, and you're not even going to have an extra staff with you. You're going to have your walking staff, and that's it. One change of clothes. You're going to pack light. "For a worker is worthy of his food. Now, whatever city or town you enter, inquire who in it is worthy." And that phrase "worthy," and I'll explain this a little bit more in detail later, it just simply means someone who is receiving Jesus as King. Receiving the message. As they're going into a city, someone's going to be worthy. And guess what? You stay there till you go out. That is, don't go from house to house. Like, whoever receives you, go into that house and stay there. Don't go to this house and then go, "You know what? That guy down the street's got a lot more money. I bet his dinners are a lot better. Let's go down the street." No. Jesus says, you go where you're received and you stay there in that village until it's time to leave. He says in verse 13, "If the household is worthy, let your peace come upon it." Shalom. As you come, shalom. As you go. "But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And whoever," listen to these words, "whoever will not receive you nor hear your words, when you depart from that house or city, shake off the dust from your feet. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city." Now, you know, when the kings of the earth and the kingdoms of the earth assert their authority here on planet Earth, when authority and sovereignty is asserted, it usually goes poorly for everyone else, doesn't it? For the king and his kingdom, it's great. But for those who are asserting their sovereignty and their power and extending their kingdom, whoever's on the edge of that kingdom is just going to get chewed up and destroyed and annihilated. That's how the kingdom of men here on earth in a fallen world, that's how it works. You can see that in bold relief right now in the war with Ukraine that Russia has instigated, right? But Jesus is a different kind of king. Now listen to me. In his incarnation, there is no one more powerful than Jesus that's ever stepped foot on planet Earth. He could have called 10,000 angels. He could have commanded the Lord of, he is the Lord of hosts, right? He burns the chariots with fire. This is who Jesus is. And when he came in his incarnation, he brought a different kind of kingdom, didn't he? First of all, he commanded his army to go pasture. Now think about that for a second. Now I know some of you have been in the military, and you know that there's a portion of the military that's in charge of taking care of folks, right? But when there's a war, those folks are, you know, there's maybe one or two at the front, but I mean, you know, most of the people in the army on the front lines, they're not really interested in helping folks, right? Got to protect the guy or the lady next to you, and you got to go forward, right? Jesus said, here's what I want you to do, guys. You're going to go out into my kingdom. You're going to go out into the world, and I want you to pastor. But he limited their mission trip. He said, make sure you're just going to the Jews. Now, I want to explain that so that you don't misunderstand what Jesus is saying. Now, how many of y'all know that our commission as a church, post-resurrection, is an all races, ends of the earth kind of commission, right? So this is one of those points at which what Jesus tells them is not what he tells us, okay? But what he tells them to do is he tells them to go to the Jews only in Galilee. He doesn't want them to go to Tyre and Sidon out on the coast. He doesn't want them to drift down into Samaria. He wants them just to focus on the Jews. And there's really three reasons for that. First of all, there's a practical reason. At this point in Jesus' ministry, his popularity is mushrooming and blowing up. He's never been more popular. And all of those people wanted to take Jesus and make him king. Remember John 6 a few weeks ago? Remember? After the feeding of the 5,000? Right, it's that desire to make him king, but Jesus knew they wanted to make him the wrong kind of king. And so Jesus wanted to control the Samaritans and all these others from coming in and causing all sorts of turmoil. There's also a personal reason. The apostles weren't ready to preach to the Samaritans and the Gentiles yet. They weren't even ready after the day of Pentecost. This was still going to be a learning curve in the first century. They even had to convene a council in Jerusalem 15 to make sure, for sure, that God is really saving Gentiles. Right? There's also a theological reason that even is echoed in the ministry of Paul, that Jesus was coming to make an honest offer of the kingdom to the Jewish people. That's what was going on here. And it would be, of course, rejected. But I want you to notice that as they went, this army, these 12 men that would multiply the work of Jesus, were going to go and gather up lost sheep. That's a different kind of army, isn't it? That's a different kind of king. Go find those who are wandering off and bring them back. In fact, Jesus commands them to go the lost sheep of Israel, and have his compassion. Verse 36 tells us that when Jesus saw all those multitudes, he saw all of those multitudes without shepherds. And so he multiplied himself in the ministry of these 12 so there could be 12 more shepherds doing the work that he was doing. The King of Heaven sent them to pastor. The King of Heaven, King Jesus, also sent them to preach in verse 7. These 12 men were commissioned to be heralds of the King. They were to go into village by village, synagogue by synagogue, city by city, house by house, announcing the kingdom, declaring the kingdom, preaching the good news of Jesus. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is right here. It's near because Jesus is near. And please listen to me. Even though we are on the other side of the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus, we are still just heralds of the kingdom. We're nothing more than a sentinel commanded to go out and to preach to this world, repent, the King of heaven has come. He's lived, he's died, he's resurrected, he's ascended, and he's coming again. And when he comes again, there will be no chance for repentance. This King of Heaven is coming. You see, this preaching was a summons to enter the kingdom of God. This preaching was a summons to prepare yourself for the coming of the kingdom of God. And I want you to understand something. This isn't an isolated thing in the Bible. Noah was a preacher of righteousness. All of the Old Testament prophets were preachers. Sometimes, I've been reading through Jeremiah, and it's not very encouraging. He did a lot of preaching from the bottom of a well. He did a lot of preaching just about half dead because he wasn't being fed. This is the kind of preaching John the Baptist did. This is the preaching that Jesus did. This is what Peter did on the day of Pentecost. He preached. This is what Peter and John did at Solomon's Gate in Acts chapter 4. They preached. This is what Paul did when he went to the Mars Hill in Acts 17 to a bunch of Gentiles who had no real grasp of the Old Testament. You know what Paul did? He did quote their prophets, but you know what else he did? He preached. He declared the gospel of Jesus Christ in his first mission trip, in his second mission trip, in his third mission trip. And when he was training Timothy, He said, Timothy, I'm getting ready to die, but I need you to tell you something. Preach the word. Even in the end times, did you know God's going to send angels that are going to fly around? And you know what they're going to be preaching. Listen to me, church. Preaching is the tip of the spear in the work of the kingdom of God. When we lose our stomach to hear it or to give it, we are useless in the kingdom of God's work here on this earth. He sent them to preach. And we are a sent people with the word of God to preach. Because here, I want to show you something. You may not know this, but look at Acts chapter 8. And I want you to see this. And remember, he's telling these 12 to go preach, right? So, well, that's fine. That's you, Brother Scott. That's your job. That's why we're here this morning. You get to get up all red-faced and preach and all that. And then we go home. But look, I want you to look at Acts 8. Because I want you to see something that's really interesting. I know many of you know this passage, but maybe you've forgotten. So in Acts chapter 8, verse 1, we have Saul, who is, we know is Paul, right? Saul's just his Hebrew name, by the way. So Saul was consenting to his death. That is, Saul was all in favor and voted for the death of Stephen, the deacon who preached. Get that. I didn't even mention him right there. Acts chapter 7, the longest sermon in the book of Acts that we have recorded, preached by a deacon. And then he died. Look out. So Saul was consenting to his death, and at that time there was a great persecution arose against the church, which was where? At Jerusalem. And they were all scattered through the regions of Judea and Samaria. So remember Acts chapter 1. Jesus says, you're going to be witnesses for me in Judea and Samaria. Oh, so these people are being scattered in all of those regions. But who didn't go into all those regions in verse 1? The apostles. Those preachers, those pastors actually stayed in Jerusalem to care for the people in the church. And look at what happens in verse 4. Well, let's just keep reading. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering every house and dragging off men and women, committing them to prison. Therefore, those who were scattered, so is that the apostles? No, that's just the regular church folk, ordinary, everyday believers. That's the blacksmiths, the shepherds, all those individual people. Maybe not apostles, but guess what they did? They went everywhere, what? Preaching the word. King Jesus sent them to preach. And isn't it such a foolish thing? Please understand, preaching, just declaring the message of the gospel to the Jews is a stumbling block because we think Jesus is the Messiah. To the Gentiles and the rest of the world, they think it's just a bunch of foolishness. But for those who will listen, it is the power of God unto salvation. And that's why we preach it. That's why your kids need to be in church. Every chance the doors are open. Because they need to hear this gospel preached and taught. This is why you need to hear this gospel preached and taught over and over and over again. This is why preachers need to listen to preaching. I need to be preached too. So I tell you, I got something to say. Well, if you got some scripture and verse, come on. We can meet. King Jesus sent them to preach. He also sent them to serve. Verse 8. Now most kings, when they come to conquer, what do they require? They require those they conquer to serve them, right? That's how it works. I beat you. I win. I get all of your resources, I get all of your taxes, I get all of your money, and when I walk into the room, you honor me. Isn't that how it works among the kingdom of men? Not with King Jesus. He arranges his army, says, okay, guys, go out there and take care of lost sheep and preach. I know it's foolish, but just preach the gospel and then serve them. I'm going to give you some gifts, and you go out and you make it better. Everything that sin has destroyed, all that Satan is doing and is undone with sin, I want you to reverse the curse of sin. I want you to raise the dead and heal the sick. Those lepers that are way off and separated, go get them and touch them and heal them and make them better. He gave them these commands. He sent them healing the sick, cleansing the lepers, raising the dead, casting out demons. Think about that for a second. Usually when you think of a king and an army, in the wake of a king and an army is devastation and destruction. In the wake of King Jesus and his 12 apostles, there was life and liberty and joy and healing. When King Jesus came to town, that's what he brought. Now I want to ask you a question. Is this community any better off because we're here? I mean, Jesus has sent us into this community, hasn't he? What's in your wake? As you go out into this world and you're trying to teach and you're trying to live your Christian life and you're trying to be what God has called us to be, are we these kinds of people that bring healing and help and hope? Because in the wake of these 12 apostles, there were lepers that got to be reunited with their families. In the wake of these 12 apostles, there were funerals that were upended. There are people who had never seen, allowed to see and get to see Jesus in the flesh. Can you imagine that? Okay, preacher, but wait, there's always a catch, right? I mean, that sounds really good, but, you know, I'm the pragmatist. Aren't you pragmatic whenever you hear that? And you keep waiting, you know, you keep scrolling in the Facebook page because, you know, they promise you something up here, but you keep scrolling until you finally get to the cost. I mean, that sounds really good, but who's going to pay the tab? Jesus said, guys, just give it away. You received it freely, give it away freely. Wow. And remember, that's exactly what Jesus did in his first coming, right? He says, even the Son of Man did not come to be served. Is Jesus the King of Heaven? But he didn't come demanding all of these people serve him. He came to this earth serving us. That's upside down, backwards, and goofy. That is not how the kings of men happen. That's not what the kingdom of Satan does either. But that's what Jesus does. Jesus was willing to pay the cost so that he could serve us and we could serve others. Now, we may not have the exact gifts that the apostles exercised, but the church is a gifted people for ministry and service. We've been given freely by Jesus. We are to give to each other and to others through service. We are commanded to do good works so that our light may shine and people may glorify our Father in heaven. We have been ordained by God in our salvation. One of the fruits of our salvation, Ephesians 2:10, he's already preordained beforehand the good works he wants you to walk in. Our life is to be just a succession of good works that makes things better. That helps. We are to serve. King Jesus sent his army to serve. He also sent his army to trust. In verses 9 through 15, first of all, they had to learn how to trust God's provision. Don't take your money, boys. Okay, wait a second, Jesus. Looks like we're going to go out 2 by 2. Yep, going out 2 by 2. You're the King of Heaven, right? Yes. We're your guys. We're the army. So no provisions. That's right. So you going to obey or not? Listen to me, church. Are we going to do what Jesus says, or are we going to look at our bank account first? Are we going? I can't afford to do that. I can't afford to give that. I can't afford to be there. I can't because it's a money issue. These men are teaching us how to trust and obey because there really is no other way. Now, this was a short-term mission trip, right? Yeah. But the long-term lesson was trust. He also told them, don't take extra clothes in verse 10. Don't take a bag. Don't take two tunics. Don't take extra pairs of sandals. And I mean, you know, I like having my black shoes and my brown shoes because if I wear my black outfit, you know, I want my shoes to kind of match. And Jesus is like, nope, don't take extra stuff. You're going to pack light, guys. They had to learn how to trust God's provision. Now, what's interesting is before the crucifixion in Luke 22:35, Jesus brings this up. And here's the question Jesus asked these apostles. He says, do you remember when I sent you out with nothing? And they're like, yeah, we remember that. And he said, did you lack anything? Do you know what their answer was? No, we didn't lack anything. That's incredible. They also needed to trust God's people. Listen to what was going to happen. Jesus knew that when these men went into these cities and into these towns, there were going to be people on the other end of that ministry who would receive his message and also receive them. And they were dependent on the fact that on the other side of them preaching the gospel and sharing the news of Jesus, that there were going to be people put there by God to receive them. And they had to trust that. Like, where are you going to stay? I don't have any money. I mean, this is a real issue of trust. I mean, they're going to be sleeping out under the stars if somebody doesn't welcome them in. They're not going to have any food to eat unless someone hears the message of Jesus and welcomes Jesus and welcomes them. It's just not going to happen. And that's by design, because Jesus wanted them to learn to trust. Some people would be worthy, and those families and those houses would receive the news of the king and receive the messengers of the king. They also needed to trust God's judgment. Verses 14 and 15, and we're going to get into this next week as we look at persecution in the next section of Scripture, because not everybody was going to... We love Jesus here. Come on in. There would be houses who didn't receive them. There would be whole villages who would run the apostles off. There were villages who ran Jesus off. Get that. Think about that for a second. Jesus came to town, heals the Gadarene demoniacs, and what did the people do? They ran him off. That didn't just happen once. It happened often. Now, in Jewish culture, when you had dealings with the Gentiles, so if you had to go into Samaria, or you had to go into a Gentile's business, or you had to go to the coast and Tyre and Sidon, and you had to hang out with Gentiles, one of the things you had to do when you got finished with that meeting is you had to clean yourself up, because those are dirty, dirty people. And I don't mean dirty physically. They were unbelieving, pagan Gentiles who didn't worship Yahweh. They were filth. They were dirt. And this was not a biblical thing to do, but that's what they did, right? And then they would shake their, she'd get the dust. I don't even want the dust of Tyre and Sidon in my sandals when I come back home. So who are these apostles talking to? Gentiles? They're talking to Jews. Jesus says, look, if you come into a village or a family and they refuse to believe in me, they refuse to receive you, they reject your message, just clean the dust off of your feet and out of your sandals and keep moving, because judgment's coming. The reason why the message that we preach is repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, is because in between the message that we preach and the Jesus who is coming is an opportunity for us to enter the kingdom by faith. But if you wait until what he talks about in verses 14 and 15, if you wait until, listen to what he says in verse 15, assuredly I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Now think about what the Jew would have understood. They know their Bible. Sodom and Gomorrah is the most debased example you could come up with, except for maybe the whole book of Judges. You know, Sodom and Gomorrah, the whole book of Judges, horrible, vile, debased, incredible immorality, so much so that God could not let it stand any longer. Like God had to deal with Sodom and Gomorrah and wipe that place out. Wipe that. That culture had become such a cesspool in what it produced that God had to judge it. And don't think that God's beyond doing that today, because he's not. Those who reject the message of Jesus, who get to hear the message of Jesus. These first century Jews, these villages, these synagogues who got to hear the apostles preach and got to see Jesus. Jesus says, look, it's going to be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah when I judge them than it will be for that city, for that village, for that synagogue, for that person. So you see, when the apostles were preaching, they had to trust that God would eventually judge. They didn't have to get violent when people didn't believe. Didn't have to get angry. Didn't have to psychologically manipulate people. Didn't have to try to make you scared. Maybe use military power. Because that always works. You know, when you tell somebody convert at the point of a gun, that always works, right? That always produces a real genuine believer, right? No. It produces a liar. And that's not the kingdom of God. Listen, anybody who ever tells you that the symbol of the cross is a symbol under which we are to arrange our armies and go conquer the world has misread the entire New Testament. It is not a symbol of conquering. It is a symbol of shame and death, where a crucified Savior died in our place and for our sins. And it is a cross that we are to also take up for ourselves and carry through this world, identifying with His shame. Church, we've got to learn to trust God as we go into this dark, cruel world with the gospel. We have to trust that He will provide. He'll provide what we need as a church and as individuals to do His work. If God's calling you to get involved in a ministry, you need to trust that He has asked you to do that, and He will provide the means to do what He's asking you to do. You need to trust God that people will respond. Not everybody, not everyone, but there will be people who respond to the gospel. We've got to trust the fact that eventually God will judge those who reject Him and His message. What a strange way to wage a war and announce a kingdom. Pastoring and shepherding people who are lost. Preaching a kingdom with no military threat. Serving and giving away healing and life and liberty without cost. And going out and blindly trusting God to provide everything that they needed. This is a different kind of king and a different kind of kingdom. So how can we learn to announce Jesus as king from this passage? Number one, as a church, we need to learn how to do it like a shepherd looking for lost sheep. We need to announce that Jesus is king like a herald announcing good news of the coming kingdom. We need to do it by serving others with our gifts and our good works and our abilities. We need to do it by trusting in the one who has sent us to provide everything we need to do His work. And here's what we need from Jesus. Because I'm telling you right now, these are four things we have to have as a church if we're going to be able to do what these apostles attempted to do. Number one, we have got to have compassion. I mean, in our current culture, you just step back and you look at this world. Okay, let's just step back and look at the culture of the church in general. And churches, we need compassion. We got whole sets of believers who don't really understand the gospel and what it means to follow Jesus. We've got people who name the name of Christ but wander far from Him. We need compassion, not only for those inside the church, but especially those outside the church. Listen, church, you remember when you were a few generations ago when people would maybe wander off and live in a prodigal way, and they would come back, right? You ever hear that story? And they would come back. And what they would come back to is the church that maybe taught them and loved on them, what their parents taught them, what their Sunday school teacher taught them. Let me tell you what's happening in our culture. This culture has nothing to go back to. Because they've never had that first experience of the gospel, the church, of the good news, of truth, or any of those things. They are lost with a capital L. They don't know what we're talking about. We need compassion. We also need courage. In our pluralistic society, one of the things we have got to get a hold of is courage. This world needs to hear that Jesus Christ is the King of Heaven. He is the way of salvation. He is the one and only source of salvation. And every single knee and every single mouth that has ever been created or will ever live will stand and then kneel and confess. All of the created order will call Jesus King. We need the courage to believe that as we proclaim it to this world. Third, we also need grace. We need grace to share our gifts and good works with others. Listen, you're a gifted person. God's put you where He's put you in this world. Go out there and do good works. Share the gifts that God has given you to influence the people around you. He's already put you where He wants you. Get busy doing good works, serving others, loving others, praying for others. And we need the faith to trust Jesus as He sends us into this world. Because sometimes it feels exactly like what He said. Behold, I send you as sheep in the midst of... Boy, it feels like that, doesn't it? We've got to learn to trust Him. So, two things to do today. Maybe you're here today and you're still giving this whole Christianity thing a... Maybe you're giving it another look. And you're wondering, 2,000 years later... Am I going to believe in this Jesus who came? Let me tell you something about the kingdom of God. 2,000 years after His death, resurrection, ascension, the kingdom of God still stands. Now, it may not look like you think it should look. In fact, here I am, short, dumpy little preacher, preaching 2,000 years later, the same thing Paul and Peter and all those others preached. And maybe you're waiting for God to do something grand and amazing to get your attention. Well, what I want to tell you is that right now as I'm speaking, that still small voice in your mind and in your heart that's telling you you need to repent, that's the King of Heaven speaking to you. And if you're waiting for some voice on high, listen, you may be right now as close to the Kingdom of Heaven as you will ever get. As weird as we are, as odd as we are, as weak as we are, the collected people together, the church, this local church, is an embassy of the kingdom of heaven because we are His subjects by faith. And if you've never trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, I want to tell you right now, He will receive you, He will forgive you, He will make you His own. And what you need to do is surrender. This King is not going to force His way into your life and beat you into submission. He's going to come gently. He's going to come clearly. And He's going to ask you. And you need to surrender. You need to quit wrestling with Him. You need to quit fighting Him. You need to give up and give in. Surrender to King Jesus. Make Him your Savior. Because listen to me. And I can say this in calmness without any, there's no red in my face, right? There's coming a day when King Jesus will come back. And every single rebel who has refused to believe Him will be judged. And it will be pure and holy justice forever. But today's the day to surrender to Him and believe Him. The second thing we need to do, if you've already surrendered to the Lord as your Savior, you need to enlist. Are you giving your life for this cause? I'm not asking you if you're coming to church on Sunday. Do you realize how easy that is? Do you realize how easy it is just to come to church, right? Listen to how easy it is for me. I get paid to come to church. Seriously. I get paid to love Jesus. It's a pretty cool gig. Seriously, I do. I've seen the checks. It's miraculous. Are you willing to give your life for Jesus? You willing to start setting aside part of your income to make sure His kingdom goes forward? Are you ready to enlist and set aside part of your time every week to make sure His kingdom goes forward? We need to enlist. There's only one cause that's worthy of our life, and it's the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. The King of Heaven used these 12 ordinary men, and that means He can use you and me. Say, well, you don't know what I've wasted so much of my life. You can't do anything about that. Here's what you can do. You can give Him every single moment going forward. You need to enlist. You need to join the King of Heaven's army and help announce His coming. Why don't you stand with me as we have a word of prayer? Father, we're so thankful today that your gospel is good news and we get to share it with others. Father, I want to pray for the person that's in this room that maybe has wandered off from you but needs to come back home. And I just pray that they would hear in these words and hear in and experience in this worship service and even as we close that you've been waiting for them to return. I also want to pray today, Father, for the person who maybe is giving Jesus one more chance. Maybe this is the day of their salvation. Lord, help them to surrender and to believe upon Jesus today. And Father, I ask you as we sing this together that we'll not just sing these words, but we will actually submit our lives and enlist ourselves in the work of your kingdom. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.
We're going to sing, Lord, I Offer My Life to You. I didn't tell you guys in the back, but we're going to go back to Lord, I Offer My Life. Sing together.
Lord, I offer my life to You, everything I've been through. Use it for Your praise to You as a pleasing sacrifice.